Hi guys, this is Melissa from WeAreMovieGeeks.com, and in celebration of the new DVD and Blu-ray Carrie, I'm about to have blood poured right on my head. So I hope you guys enjoy. On the movie Carrie, I never really thought of it as an anti-bullying type of movie, but in a weird way it is. Do you think the timing was right to retell this story?
Absolutely. I think what was amazing was Stephen King wrote an amazingly prescient novel in the 1970s, and in many ways he foresaw where things were going. I mean, for him to tell that story about a girl who was outcast and who was routinely bullied by the other girls, and then who wanted to find her place in the school and ended up getting mad and, you know, taking her revenge. We didn't read about stories like that back then. Mm-hmm. But now we read about them all the time. I mean, sadly, they're on the internet. I mean, whether it's, you know, a girl from Ireland who comes over and, you know, she's bullied because she's too pretty, or it's somebody who's bullied because of their weight or, you know, their sexual orientation or, you know, the color of their skin. I think bullying is a huge issue. And I think it was amazing that we had 40 years between when it was first told and now.
Now, as a writer and a director, what made an adaptation? What made you want to do an adaptation this time around?
I want to do an adaptation because when I read the novel, I fell madly in love with Carrie White. That the way Stephen King writes her in the book, she's so present, she's so alive. You know, she's so clear about what she wants, which is love and acceptance, and the obstacles against her getting it are just so severe. She can't get it at school, she can't get it at home. I think what's amazing is, you know, her relationship with her mother. Here's a woman who is completely religious, who loves her daughter completely, and is terrified of sexuality. She's got a girl, a daughter who's going through adolescence. So what's she going to do? She's got a huge conflict in her hands. And the way King tells it, you're in love with her. And you know that she loves her daughter, yet you may not support the ways that she ends up, you know, disciplining her. And then it's a great superhero origin story.
One thing I noticed in this film compared to the other one, I feel like the transformation of Carrie from the beginning to when she starts to come into her powers and come into her own is she's a very attractive girl. And it definitely, the transformation is more extreme. Was that something you definitely wanted to show and that as her confidence grew in the film, that she becomes a more attractive woman?
Absolutely. So what I did was I worked on, because Chloe was more the age of the person in the book, I already had a girl who was young and who was not really developed, you know, sexually. And we tried to make her unattractive, but you didn't want to make her so unattractive that it was distracting. So we ended up, we did a lot of exploration about what her hair would look like, what her skin would look like, what her clothes would look like. And it was always trying to make her a misfit in the way she looked, but not make it hideous or not make it over the top. Because if you did, people would just say, that's unbelievable.
Absolutely. Was there a particular scene or shot that you knew you wanted to carry over from the original, or did you want to just do it all yourself?
There wasn't a particular shot that I wanted to carry over, and I did want to do it all myself, but I'm not blind to the fact that I probably was influenced by Brian De Palma's masterpiece. So if you see echoes of his work in mine, I think that's just because as an artist, you know, well, A, he did a great job. And so if he's done a good job, it's really hard. I don't want to suddenly not do a good job just to be different. But I think the other thing is, you know, artists are cultural consumers. And so we consume this stuff and it kind of flows through us. So there's going to be echoes.